So Mihaela van der Schaar is the John Humphrey Plummer Professor of Machine Learning, Artificial Intelligence and Medicine at the University of Cambridge, where she leads one of the most impactful and diverse teams in the field. She employs a wide range of machine learning approaches, including deep learning, causal inference, time series analysis, ensemble learning, and many more, all with the ultimate goal of improving healthcare and medical knowledge. And her title today is Quantitative Epistemology, How Machine Learning Can Help Humans Become Better decision makers. So Mihaela, thank you again for taking time out. I know you're extremely busy, but we really look forward to hearing your talk.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. Sorry for the little glitch over here. Hopefully I can minimize, hope you can still see my screen.
Yes, we can see a slide, the first slide, yeah.
Excuse me, I've done this billions of times and still every time I do it. So you can still see my screen well, in yes. Full screen and everything. Yes. That's wonderful.
Yeah,
that's wonderful. Okay, so thank you so much. It is my great pleasure to give this invited talk at the BNA today. And I really hope that several of you will become interested in the agenda that I'm going to describe here, since it is an interdisciplinary research agenda that would very much benefit from collaboration with your field. Usually when we think about meta-learning in my community, the machine learning community, we think about something very different. We think about computer algorithms, transferring knowledge across tasks and domains, and efficiently learning new tasks, optimizing the machine learning process itself. So we are focusing on how computers learn. However, in this talk today, I'm going to go back to the origins of the meta-learning field, which focuses on human learning rather than computer learning, and discuss how can we use machine learning to empower human learning. So Donald Maudsley, the father of meta-learning, defined it as the process by which learners, human learners, become aware of and increasingly in control of habits of perception, inquiry, learning, and growth. Today, I'm going to give as an example how clinicians are performing meta-learning, but this work is generally applicable. And Maudsley has defined 5 different principles that the learners must adopt in order to do meta-learning. They must have a theory, discover the rules and assumptions, reconnect with reality information from the environment, reorganize themselves by changing the rules and assumptions, and work in a supportive environment. But the reality is that performing meta-learning is hard for humans. So we decided to develop a new machine learning field aimed at empowering humans to do meta-learning as well as to take better decisions. And we call this area quantitative epistemology, where epistemology stands for the study of knowledge and quantitative for things that can be measured. Really is this quantitative epistemology and how can we plan to build this new human-machine learning partnership and building in the process a theory for meta-learning. So humans act and make decisions and perform meta-learning. And on the basis of this, quantitative epistemology will learn, and I'm going to give a few examples later, and unravel assumptions, structures, rules, and way in which people adapt their beliefs and behaviors, thereby extracting meta-learning models, on the basis of which we can distill hypotheses about meta-learning and build the theory of meta-learning that Maudsley is talking about. And that can be reconnected then with reality information from the environment and adapted over time. When we are confident that this meta-learning is useful, we can use it to generate advice and empower humans, which may then decide to adopt this information and improve their abilities and capabilities using this type of methodologies. Also, Maudsley is talking about building a supportive environment for meta-learning. As humans are taking actions, quantitative epistemology can extract online meta-learning models, observations about potential biases, systematic errors and inconsistencies in behavior, and even provide advice about how humans can improve. And this is provided to humans, which can then provide implicit and explicit feedback to quantitative epistemology, either in the form of implicit feedback, purely by changing their actions or not, or explicit feedback, by giving information about adjustments and corrections, clarifications and ratings about the information received. And thereby we can build a supportive human-machine partnership. At a first glance, this may look like a decision support system, but it is not. It is a paradigm shift. In a decision support system, decision makers, and let me give an example of a potential decision maker, a clinician, is provided with action recommendations before he or she makes a decision. But in quantitative epistemology, the decision makers are provided continuously with information about potential mistakes that they may make when it may take an action, systematic errors. Their intended decisions can be validated prior to them making decisions. And they can discuss with the machine about the potential recommendations they would like to have and have information that is provided to them, thereby becoming more aware and avoiding cognitive biases. Also, recommendation can be provided in terms of training. Stakeholders, which can be in this case patients, can understand using quantitative epistemology the reasons behind the decisions being made and ensure that the right decision is made in their behalf. And this can be done after a decision is made as well as continuously. Supervisors and managers, for instance, hospital managers, can detect systematic errors, analyze variation in practice, monitor behavior, or recommend training. And policymakers, which may provide clinical practice guidelines, can assess current practice and measure the impact of new policies. And trainers and teachers can find best ways to give information and assess how much is learned and provide personalized continuous learning, which is extremely important into a complex and rapidly evolving field such as medicine. And finally, researchers, and here I'm not talking about medical researchers, but rather about cognitive science researchers as well as meta-learning researchers such as Maudsley, can analyze behavioral data, form hypotheses, and contribute to decision-making theory and meta-learning. So what have we done so far? We have looked at, for instance, how human agents are making decisions in a timely, if they are pressured by time, they need to make it in a timely manner, such as, for instance, timely diagnosis. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. What reward function does a human optimize when making a decision? How important are possible counterfactuals and alternatives in the decision-making process? What are subjective beliefs that the human is considering? And how does the behavior of a human evolve over time as they are making decisions in a particular environment? Quite a lot of this was summarized into a framework that we have recently presented at one of our machine learning conferences, and this is called inverse decision modeling. So inverse decision modeling, or for short IDM, provides us with a general framework for learning representations of human meta-learning and decision-making behavior. We start with understanding observed behavior in decision-making, and we ask the question, what does observed behavior look like relative to an ideal normative behavior? And here a normative behavior could be a standard for evaluating or making judgments about behavior or outcomes. And the work in the machine learning community on, for instance, before that, I just want to acknowledge that this work was done together with two of my brilliant PhD students, Dan Jarrett and Alian Huyuk. How does this differ with the general machine learning agenda? In the machine learning community, the issues that we are describing here, which are about human empowerment and empowering human meta-learning, are completely disregarded. For instance, the work on imitation learning focuses on replicating expert actions, while the work on apprenticeship learning focuses on matching the expert returns with the overall goal of replacement rather than understanding the imperfect human decision-making with the overall role of supporting it. In particular, beyond the utility-driven nature of rationality for human behaviors, we wish to quantify intuitive notions of bounded rationality, such as how flexible are humans in taking a particular decision or changing it. And we wish to create representations that are interpretable such that humans can engage with the unraveled findings, and hence we can create projections of observed behaviors into parameters that are meaningful and parsimonious for humans. So inverse decision modeling is a type of inverse analysis that infers a representation from the existing observed behavior, and in order to do so, it leverages the normative ideal, which describes what the human agent or the community of humans thinks is the best way to solve the decision-making problem at hand. Since the behavior representation obtained by IDM is given with respect to this normative ideal, we can easily use it to generate prescriptive advice for the human agent that would guide them towards this normative ideal. And this advice could come in the form of new guidelines, for instance. And on the basis of this new advice and new guidelines, the observed behavior would, of course, change, after which we can use again IDM to infer a representation of this new behavior and issue new advice, thereby continuously improving human behavior in a feedback cycle. How can we model an agent's behavior? We can use the standard decision-making setup. And here at some time step, the agent is in some internal state Z and they can take an action determined by some decision policy. I'm going to give a concrete example. And their action causes the environment to transition to a new external state S and emit an observation, which the agent then uses to update its internal state according to some recognition policy. I'm going to give the example of medical diagnosis in a little bit. And how do we now do inverse decision modeling? Suppose we are given some observations of a human making decisions over time, and we are going to partition the planning parameters into a normative part and to a descriptive part, and the inverse planner will aim to find the descriptive part of the planning parameters given the normative part, such that the behavior induced by the two is as close as possible to what we see in the demonstrated behavior. A better way to conceptualize this operation is to think of it as a projection of the demonstrated behavior into the space of behaviors that all satisfy the same normative standards. In our framework, those normative standards are specified in the form of a forward planner and a fixed set of normative planning parameters. And what we've been calling so far inverse decision modeling is essentially this projection operation. And this formalism not only subsumes a wide range of existing algorithms and methods, but it also opens up new possibilities for interpretative research on meta-learning. I'm going to describe today the incarnation of inverse decision modeling as inverse bounded rational control, which is interpretable, expressive, and applicable in many settings in real world. So let us start by describing a bounded rational planner, a human, as part of our normative specification. We will assume that the human has uncertain knowledge of the environment in which they operate, which is given as a prior over the transition and emission dynamics. However, we will also allow the agent to deviate from this prior based on their internal state according to some specification policy. Assuming that the agent would have performed Bayesian inference as the recognition policy if they were to know the environment perfectly, the overall recognition of the agent could be described as an aggregate of such inferences weighted according to their specification policy. Then the bounded rational planner aims to maximize the expected utility over time, much like we usually do in standard reinforcement learning or in operations research, but with additional constraints on how much the human's decision, specification, and recognition policies can deviate from these pre-specified priors due to bounded human rationality. And solving such an optimization problem, so the human making the long-term utility, is similar to value iteration rules from reinforcement learning, but this time with complexity terms discouraging deviations from prior decision specification and recognition policies. For instance, we are going to take how freely a human can deviate from the prior decision policy as a measure of his flexibility, how freely he can deviate from the prior specification policy as a measure of his optimism, and how freely he can deviate from the prior recognition policy as a measure of his adaptability. So let's look at inverse bounded rational control and let's understand how suboptimally an agent appears to behave. And for this, we are going to consider medical diagnosis. And the reason we do that is because we observe in practice remarkable regional, institutional and subgroup variability. The example I'm going to give a little bit later is about Alzheimer and Alzheimer diagnosis, which at times is done late, too late, or conversely, at other times, unnecessary tests are given to the patient. But I'm going to give first a very toy example to illustrate the key ideas. And such normative questions are only possible within the IDM framework. So, of flexibility, optimism, and adaptivity on behavior, I'm going to consider a simple toy example for medical diagnosis first. And in this environment, patients are either disease negative or disease positive, and some type of measurements are taken at every step, noisily, indicating the patient's underlying disease state. Then the decision clinicians need to make is whether to keep monitoring the patient one more step and collect more evidence for the diagnosis, or stopping and declaring a final diagnosis that is either negative or positive. Our normative specification of the utility function is such that correct diagnoses are awarded a utility of 10 and incorrect minus 36, while a cost of 1 is given for monitoring the patient one more step. And since monitoring is expensive, the question is, how does the clinician decide whether the value of what is learned and hence monitor is outweighed by the benefit of declaring the diagnosis? Let's see what's happening within the IDM framework. In every figure, the x-axis will represent the clinician's subjective posterior for their patient's true disease state, and the y-axis represents the action probabilities. And the curves represent the different possible actions, and the red markers show when the posterior is updated as more positive observations are made. A caution here. These are not the belief trajectories over time, but rather the belief states of the human agent. And in this figure, we can see the effect of flexibility on behavior. The flexible agent is more willing to wait for information and has a sharp threshold for declaring diagnosis, while the inflexible agent is never very certain about the diagnosis because he keeps waiting for more information and is stuck in his original beliefs. And as you can see, the action of the inflexible agent is much more stochastic compared to the flexible agent. And this is related to the concept of behavioral inconsistency in psychology. In the next figure, optimism on behavior. While the optimistic agent believes observations to be much more informative than they actually are and update the subjective posterior accordingly, the pessimistic agent believes them to be less informative, and hence the pessimistic agent makes observations sooner. This is related to over and under reaction. And in the final figure, we see the effect of adaptivity on behavior. The non-adaptive agent requires less evidence before he declares a final diagnosis, and the adaptive agent is more willing to wait for new information, and this is related to the concepts of base neglect and confirmation bias. Now, to illustrate how this method works in practice, let us consider the decision-making problem of ordering or not an MRI during the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. And we know that while MRI is often informative of Alzheimer's, it is also costly. And Alzheimer progression is categorized into three stages: normal function, mild cognitive impairment, and dementia. And this represents the three states that I described previously. And the actions are whether to do an MRI or not. And observations are, we consider the cognitive test functions and the MRI outcomes of patients. And in order to learn effectively, we use the real data set, the ADNI data set, and look at the variation in practice in this particular data set. So what we try to do using the ADNI data set is recover the optimism parameter that I showed to you before for all patients at once. And we do the same afterwards for different subgroups of patients. And we see that clinicians appear to be significantly less optimistic with diagnosing patients with the APOE4 genetic risk factor, female patients, and patients over the age of 75, which also happen to be the patients who are more at risk. However, if we think about the previous graphs related to optimism, we know that this is not a matter of priors. This is a matter of posteriors. So the pessimistic clinician requests a new MRI at a lower value of his posterior. I hope that gives you a very brief idea about what we are trying to do in quantitative epistemology, which we believe to be a multidisciplinary research field where we hope to join forces with researchers like you and develop tools that can enable and empower us to make better decisions and do meta-learning more effectively. And again, the focus of this agenda is to partner with humans to empower them, not to replace them. I believe that we can learn a lot from you in this area, so I hope that you can reach out to us if you are interested in this and join forces with us. If you want to read more about this agenda, please take a look at our website where we have a research pillar dedicated to it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mihaela. Really amazing stuff that you're doing, and really important stuff. Just to remind
you, it was not so funny. I realized it should have been Ding Dong Merry, and I'm not sure it was so merry, but hopefully.
No, it's fine. We want a combination of good science and research as well as frivolity. But so that was a good example of a really important and cutting edge research. Just to remind the audience that if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box. But while people are thinking, let me ask for clarification, really. So in your inverse decision modeling, you have this sort of normative reference. Where does that come from in many medical situations? What is optimal there?
So what would be optimal there, for instance, could be clinical practice guideline or the current believed clinical practice guideline, where you are going to see people deviating from it.
Right.
And you will see that some people may do something very different than the rest. However, this could also be a setting where we can learn over time that improved guidelines will need to come for a subset of patients. It could also be the clinical consensus, the current consensus that the researcher in that particular field find as a good way of practicing. It could also be potentially clinicians wanting to learn a new skill, and this could be the target to gather this knowledge or to behave in a certain way. Or it could be coming from a teacher. So the normative guideline can come from a teacher like you, teaching students how to really act in different types of environments. So we even envision scenarios where this will not be static. I didn't discuss them much here in view of time, but we even consider this to be conversation potentially, where this normative ideal would not be something really prescriptive like in a guideline, but rather a conversation with somebody that's more informed about that particular setting.
Could it also come from historically?
Oh, sorry, if you allow me to say, so I don't know that I explained this very well, but the point is that currently when we talk to experts, even in the same field, to clinicians or to neuroscientists, we often use words. And words are good, but they are at times vague if we want to make decisions in complex settings, like for instance, for a specific patient. So this obliges us to come up with a somewhat more formal and more rigorous language on the basis of which we can discuss, understand that particular case and conquer it.
Yeah, no, it's definitely clear that we need a more formal way of expressing these concepts. But if you take the example you gave of, a diagnosis of dementia, when you...
Very simplistic, sorry.
No, but when you're estimating a parameter like pessimism, what is that pessimism relative to? I mean, I can understand how if you have historic data and you know the eventual outcome of a patient that they, from pathology where they do have Alzheimer's disease, and therefore you can look back earlier in time and see whether the right diagnosis was made at the right time. But
I apologize. I misused some of the, I gave them meaning, if you like. Yeah. So,
But what's
defined pessimism here very concretely, actually.
You did define it completely.
I define it here as a measure of optimism or pessimism. And it is indeed with respect to future outcomes and with respect to expected outcomes in the value function in the long run.
So
we assume a reward function there.
Right. So when you're saying that the clinicians were pessimistic in their view, for example, for APOE carriers or females, whatever, that was relative to the actual outcome many years later when it turned out that they shouldn't have been so pessimistic. I see. Okay.
Yeah. And it is even when adjusted for the risk factor. So it's not about priors, it's about posteriors, which is interesting. Adjusted for that. Of course, everything I show here is somewhat toy and hinges on this representations of human learning, human behavior, how humans adapt their knowledge over time. So that's the reason I see a tremendous value. I hope I interested a few of you to be interested to converse with us machine learners who know very little about how humans think, adjust, adapt, meta-learn, because good representation of this mental ability of us to integrate information would be very, very helpful. And it's very toy here.
Yeah, definitely need more conversation between the neuroscientists and clinicians and machine learning experts. There's one question just come in, if we could keep it very brief in the answer, because we're starting to run over, but Stefano Casalotti asks, once a clinician will start getting feedback from AI, they will modify their behavior. Is there a risk that everyone will converge to the same behavior and we lose the richness of thoughts and approaches that lead to discussion and discovery?
So thank you for this question. So I would argue not. What the focus is here is the discovery and the discussion will become more precise. This is exactly what we were trying to say, that people will not talk past each other, but rather will have a much more formal language of exposing that. So the focus here, as I mentioned in the beginning, is not recommendation, it's not recommending things, but rather exposing the thinking to other human beings. Number two, I would argue that you don't want a clinician to experiment on you if there is good, solid evidence of thinking in a particular way. You don't want to be positively or even worse, negatively discriminated when you are informed by the clinician. So again, the focus here is not on recommendation, but rather exposing these different meta-learning and decision processes such that they become more rigorous and more formal and people can debug each other.
Great. Thank you very much again, Mihaela.
Thank you for inviting me.